And engaging the dragon is the final love affair of some movies through their visit to China, and it is the business end of the visit, with Ian Murray going all out to greet Chinese CEOs in Shanghai. Today, Prime Minister Narendra Modi made his mission of the office to Chinese companies, assuring a stable and transparent business environment, calling China the factory of the world and India the back office of the world. Ian Murray said that together the two countries can bring progress in business.
I'm here to assure you that India's economic environment has changed. Our regulatory regime is much more transparent, responsible, and stable. We are taking a long-term and futuristic views on this issue. Lot of efforts have been made and are still underway to improve the ease of doing business. We do believe that foreign direct investment is important, and it will not come in the country without globally competitive business environment. We are making the taxation system transparent, stable, and predictable. We have removed lot of regulatory taxation regimes. In our very first budget, we say we will not resort to retrospective taxation.
And the Prime Minister speaking to the corporates in China. Now let's go across to Shireen Bhan, who is currently in Shanghai, who has been tracking the Prime Minister's visit very closely. Shireen, tell us what's happening there.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi met with Chinese investors and Chinese business leaders here at the India-China Business CEO Forum, and his message to them was clear. If you decide to do business in India, then you have my personal assurance that I will make it easy for you to invest in India. Through his speech today, the Prime Minister touching upon all of those usual themes, whether it's smart cities, infrastructure financing, railways development, affordable housing, low-cost housing, digital India, making India, all of those themes were what the Prime Minister pitched to Chinese investors here, all to continue to maintain the position of the government that they will provide a more facilitating environment, there will be consistency and certainty as far as tax policy is concerned, there will be no retrospective taxation, that the government will ensure it can do whatever it possibly can to facilitate investment into the country, that India is open to foreign direct investment. Well, that's the story. How much of that will actually be bought by Chinese investors is a question, but at this point in time, the reactions coming in from the likes of Alibaba and Xiaomi suggest that they like what they hear. Xiaomi, for instance, saying that they have big plans lined up in India. Alibaba may also potentially be looking at deals in India. In fact, incidentally, Snapchat open eyeball is here. If something brewing, that's when the buzz. I tried to get him to try to put him down to answer that question. Haven't got an answer just yet. But 22 MOUs being signed here today, including the likes of Adani Ports, Adani Power, the Welsh Fund Group, ICICI Bank has now decided to set up its first branch in China after having set up its first representative office 12 years ago in the country. Infosys is going to be setting up a campus here in Shanghai, showcasing the model of the campus here to Prime Minister Modi at the CEO Forum. You've got others, including Bharat Forge, Amit Kalyani, Karan Bengal, Mahindra and Mahindra here to assess the opportunities and to talk to their counterparts from a Chinese industry. But largely in terms of infrastructure financing and project financing, both of the MOUs that have been inked today, and it's interesting because there is no such thing as a free lunch, so all of these MOUs do come with riders. For instance, when I spoke to Wealth Fund did say that they will have to source equipment from China. Similarly, BPS will also confirm that they will have to source equipment from Chinese manufacturers like Huawei and ZTE as part of the MOUs and the agreements that have been inked here today. So let's the mood positive, but a lot more needs to be done, which is clearly articulated by the fact that you've had another committee being set up, a high task force being set up this time around to look at the issues that hold back investments and to look at issues that could be addressed to correct the trade imbalance between India and China. We don't have clarity on when this task force will present its recommendations and when those recommendations will be acted on. But for now, Indian companies continue to face difficulties when it comes to accessing markets in China, when it comes to accessing contracts given out by state-owned enterprises. But hopefully the road ahead, if both Prime Minister Modi and President Xi are to be believed, the road ahead looks better or will be better for both sides when it comes to collaboration and investment. So it's the end of the CEO forum here in Shanghai, and the headline there is about 22 MOUs being inked worth over $20 billion.
Well, thanks a lot for that. In that it gets down to business in China, actually, it was just telling us 21 MOUs have been signed between Indian and Chinese companies. That's worth as much as $22 billion have been signed between the two nations. In fact, Bharti Airtel has inked an MOU with China Development Bank and ICBC Bank for about $2.5 million of investment. Let's listen to this exclusive conversation that Shailen Bhan had with Rajan Bharti Airtel of Bharti Airtel.
Bharti Airtel has signed an MOU with a China financial institution, CDB and ICBC Bank, for about $2.5 billion. So $2 billion is with CDB Bank and $500 million with ICBC Bank.
What do you have to do with it?
So this is for a $1 billion that has been kept for the equipment supplies that come in, both from India and Africa, Huawei, ZTE and others from China. And $1 billion has been signed for spectrum, again, the spectrum that we have just won in India. So that's the funding should be needed. Of course, we need to have the approvals and all other issues that needs to come around.
The agreement specifically as far as equipment, the loan for the equipment is concerned, that is conditional on the fact that the equipment will be from Chinese manufacturers like Huawei and ZTE?
Predominantly, yes. That will be part of the agreement which will come through.
But this is only for the African market, not for the Indian market.
Look, India.
India.
And Africa, yeah. So wherever they are in Africa, they were in India, so it's linked to that.
And what kind of tenure are we talking about?
10 years.
What has the experience been so far for you here in China? And do you believe that there is any significant forward movement on the contentious issues? Because another committee has been set up to address some of those issues. So clearly that seems to suggest that there hasn't really been much forward movement.
Well, I think there is a flavor as far as China is concerned, and that is predominantly seen as the Prime Minister's visit. Of course, those issues remain on the, and Prime Minister himself spoke about it, that those issues remain on the table, yet the economic side has to grow. We can't park because of the because of that political issue. So I think both have to go hand in hand.
And then I'm moving away from the telecom space. Even ICICI Bank is planning to set up a branch in China. Shireen also caught up with Chandra Kochhar, the CMD of ICICI Bank, and also about the opportunities that this will open for the bank.
Actually, we've been present in China for 12 years. We set up a representative office in 2003, but we now got the license to convert it into a full-fledged branch. What kind of an opportunity is this going to be as far as you're concerned? You see the trade relations between the countries are so large and can only get bigger. So for us, the opportunity is all the Indian companies that are setting up and growing their businesses in China, the Chinese companies that would want to set up their businesses in India, and the entire underlying trade relations between the two countries on both sides, plus the diaspora area, which is of course small but growing in number. Seeing that we have an opportunity and we've got a significant imbalance as far as our trade is concerned, but do you see things changing? There has been a high task force that's been set up now to try and correct the trade imbalance. What's your own sense and what are the factors that you really see that we are going to see Indian investments coming into China?
Well, Indian investments have already started coming into China, but in order to rebalance the trade, so to say, we also have to attract Chinese investments into India. And I think clearly what we have to make this possible is to identify those areas where we have complementary strengths. China has strengths in sectors like core infrastructure, in railways, in smart cities, and in mass production. And India has the ability to use technology, designing, and so on. Plus, of course, create a large manufacturing base, which the Chinese companies can use as a manufacturing hub over the world. And more importantly, a big market for their goods and services. So it's really in this, keeping this in mind that you could identify sectors like very core infrastructure like railways, like power equipment, like other kinds of capital goods, that can be important sectors for collaboration.
In terms of expansion, are you starting with this one branch? What kind of plans would you have as far as expansion is concerned? And also in terms of the regulatory framework, because there are conditions attached to banks, MNC banks, including their presence in India, what kind of regulatory arrangement is it in China for banks like this?
I think here the process is actually in that sense pretty clear that you first have to work here as a representative office, establish your credentials here, and then over a period you get the license to convert it into a branch. And that's essentially the evolution that they've gone through. And right now I think it's really from this branch in Shanghai that we'd look to do our business in China, both just not just in China, but the China-India corridor.
Alright, we would welcome banking space and infra financing. IMFS Infra has also inked two MOUs for infrastructure financing. Manish Bawa, the CEO of IMFS Financial Services, says that China's royal group will invest up to $3 billion in the company's power project in Kutch. Let's listen to that conversation as well.
One of the MOUs we have signed basically the ICBC, which is one of the largest banks here. And the understanding is basically there will be financing our infrastructure projects at $1 billion. That's one MOU. It will be done also by Hangar Bhotis. The second MOU basically we have signed with the Honan Group, which is one of the state-owned largest power producer company in the China. And they have done an understanding with us to make investment of up to $3 billion in one of our projects in Kutch district, Gujarat.
Which project is it, sir?
It is the Marina Leisure project in Kutch district, Gujarat.
Okay. And what are the terms of the agreement and what kind of time period will be talking about for the loan?
Basically, right now, it is an additional MOU that possibly they will be able to take about 75% of the stake, maybe holding about 25%. And
in that power project? And the other one that you talked about, the other MOU that you talked about, have you been able to identify specific infrastructure projects?
Basically, they have made the beginning. In fact, they are the initial amount, they have the sanction for $50 million. And the rest of the amount, basically, we have identified the projects which they will be financing step by step.
Ashwini has been an active visitor in China and she also caught up with Jyoti Golka, the chairman of Nestle Corp, and began by asking him about the details of the MOUs that he signed for the company.
We have signed two MOUs, one for the solar park and manufacturing of solar panels with the Trina Solar Company, and another is to make special steel in Gujarat.
What will be the size of both these investments? Is it essentially project financing? Can you give us details on what this means?
Mainly it's project financing, and for the solar we are looking for around $400 million, and for the steel we will be around $2 billion.
Over what period of time?
In the next 2 to 3 years.
Any conditions attached to the MOUs that have been signed today?
I mean, there are certain conditions, but I think it's a question of sorting out the finding.
Will the solar panels have to come from China?
Yes.
They will have to come from China.